Let's talk about the link between faith and risk. And I'll start with this question. Is it true that some people are just born lucky? Well, psychologist Richard Wiseman did a fascinating study over the course of 10 years with 400 people. Now, he found these people when he placed ads in all kinds of newspapers asking for people to sign up for the study if they thought of themselves as very lucky or very unlucky. So he studies them for 10 years, asks them to keep diaries. Guess what he discovered? Those who saw themselves as lucky were indeed luckier. Better stuff happened to them. They got more good breaks. But why? As he observed the diaries, he noticed that the lucky people, those who thought of themselves as lucky, tend to risk more. They put themselves out there. They try more stuff. They fail more often, but then they shrug it off and they try something else. And because they try more stuff, it's just more probable that good stuff is going to happen to them too. On the other hand, the people who see themselves as unlucky crave security, so they do not risk. And as a result, they miss out on thousands of opportunities. Now, imagined luckiness or unluckiness is, of course, not the same as biblical faith, but in some surprising verses, Jesus Christ himself seems to commend that kind of adventurous risk-taking, putting yourself out there, seeing what happens. Jesus tells this parable that kind of haunts me. After two servants take risks with their master's resources and report great profits, he says, the last servant said, "Master, I was afraid I might disappoint you, so I found a good hiding place and secured your money. Here it is, safe and sound, down to the last cent." The master was furious. "That's a terrible way to live," he said. "It's criminal to live cautiously like that." Wow. Jesus' point seemed to be that risk, when taken in faith for God, is commendable. In other words, failure is not the greatest risk. The greatest risk is never trying. And that brings me to Abraham's story. The author to the Hebrews says, by faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. Now, to get some historical context, the story of Abraham is set 2,000 years before Jesus, 4,000 years before us, so this is ancient history. In fact, human civilization is just starting. The city of Ur in the land of Samaria, where Abraham is from, that's in the region of Mesopotamia, where Iran and Iraq are now, it was known as the Fertile Crescent. It's where crop cultivation started. In other words, farming was invented there. Cities were invented there. Brick-making technology was invented there, and so much more. This was all in Abraham's life. So his hometown was safe, it was secure, it was civilized, it was clean, it was orderly, and God calls him to leave. And check this out. Even though he's not told where to go, how far to go, how long it'll take, or how he'll even know when he gets there, Abraham risks everything and goes. So Abram went as the Lord had told him, sort of the original leap of faith. I see two huge faith lessons here in Abraham's story that seem to be the point for his inclusion in the book of Hebrews. First, faith is risking when God sends you. Abraham responds in faith to God's call. Like somebody said, faith means starting the journey when you cannot see the final destination. As the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. put it, faith is taking the first step even when you don't see the whole staircase. And the Hebrews author is clearly saying, in that way, be like Abraham. First you hear the call, God saying, yes, you are chosen, and then you respond with faithful action. Second faith lesson here, faith is believing when God says he'll provide for you. And this brings us to the most famous part of Abraham's story. Remember, God had promised Abraham that he would be the father of a great nation through a son he would have with his wife, Sarah. Big problem, 24 years later, and Abraham and Sarah still do not have a son. They are elderly. They are way past childbearing age. Where's God's provision? Well, miraculously, Sarah has a baby, Isaac. God's promise has come true. Yeah, but then God appears to Abraham in the final time he will ever appear in a vision to this man. And he says this, take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to a mountain I will show you. And then he asks the unimaginable, sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you. What? And what happens next is riveting. I mean, especially if you're just hearing the story for the first time, you're just on the edge of your seat, hanging on every line. Abraham asks Isaac to join him on their trip up to the mountain. He turns and tells his servants, we will go and worship and we will return. Remember that, we. On the way up, Isaac asks his dad, where's the animal for the sacrifice? And Abraham answered, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And the two of them went on together. And then the tension really builds. Reading this, we can hardly believe what is happening. Isaac is bound to the altar. The knife is raised. And just as Abraham is about to sacrifice his only son, an angel appears. And he says, stop! Do not lay a hand on the boy. Do not do anything to him. And it says, Abraham looked up and there in the thicket, he saw a ram caught by its horns. And he went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. Abraham was right. God himself did provide the sacrifice. Isaac was safe. Okay, that's great, but what is the point of this weird story? Why is it even in the Bible? What's it supposed to teach us? Well, for one thing, this has served for centuries as kind of the go-to passage for missionaries serving in cultures where human sacrifice is practiced, and that includes many ancient cultures, maybe most. This story was God telling all of our human ancestors across all those cultures and across all those centuries, stop. Stop that forever. And personally, I think God made this story so riveting because, well, you don't change cultures with a boring story. The Abraham and Isaac story also led to the development of the whole sacrificial system of the Jewish temple in Jerusalem, the whole idea of substitutionary atonement. Until God provides the sacrifice to end even the temple sacrificial system. Earlier in Hebrews, the author explains, it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. We have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. No more ritual sacrifice is needed of anything, ever. God is saying across cultures and across centuries, stop that. Stop it forever. I have provided the sacrifice. And when you trust in Jesus Christ as God's provision for you, then you are trusting in the same thing that Abraham trusted in. You are having faith that God has provided for you. Now, do you remember how Abraham tells his servants, we will worship and we will come back to you? We, both of them. That shows us that from the very beginning, Abraham believes Isaac is coming back. Somehow. The author to the Hebrews suggests that Abraham might have even believed that God would raise Isaac from the dead if needed, but he knew that God's promise was true, that through Isaac there would be a great nation. Simply put, Abraham believed God would come through, and he did. So how about you? Do you believe in God's provision for your sin in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ? Then you don't have to do any more sacrifices, any more works to try to earn his favor. God has provided the sacrifice. Now, if that is settled for you, then do you tend to demonstrate adventurous faith, or do you tend to stay conservative with your risks? True confessions here. I tend not to be a risk taker. I tend to play it safe. But I've discovered that adventurous, risk-taking faith is rewarding. Now, again, this is not something I was born with. This is something I grew into over the years. And you can too. You know, I was surprised that well-known Manhattan pastor Tim Keller says he is not by nature a risk taker either. In fact, he tends to be afraid of failure. So he wrote a little pep talk for himself that he has kept in his wallet for years when he finds himself afraid to take risks. And recently he kind of revealed this to the world. And I want to read this to you as we close. Why am I afraid of failure? Do I live by my performance or on the basis of Christ's power? Have I gotten this far on my efforts or by the grace of God? What will I lose through failure anyway? I still have God's love, His kindness, and if I do fail here, He will only use this to prepare me for something greater. My worthiness is not based on my success. Jesus is my security. And as a result, I don't have to worry about failure here. I'm free from fear. That is appropriate risk-taking faith. That is what it looks like to live faith forward.